Hello there! Miss Coffee Bean, the audience has spoken. The last video was about positional embeddings with sines and cosines, as it was introduced in the Attention is All You Need paper. You wrote us in the comments that you want to know even more about positional encodings, so here it is, again a video about them. This video is about the question, when to add or when to concatenate positional embeddings to the initial input representation. Then we will talk a bit about learned positional embeddings. So, welcome to this AI coffee break, your coffee infusion enabling you to become a positional embedding expert. Or not. First, let's dive a little bit into the two ways to handle positional embeddings in general. In the last video, we showed the attention is all you need way, where positional embeddings are added to the vector initial representation of tokens. Then we have seen what an act of balance this addition is. By the way, if you did not watch the video, now it is the time. Go watch it and come back here for more. No, Miss Coffee Bean, not you. You stay here and do this video with me. So, when adding positional encodings to the vector representation, ideally they contain some semantic information about the token already, but we would like to make the positional information also strong enough so the model does not overlook it, and also not too strong so it does not overtone the semantic similarities in that vector space. A proof that this is indeed an act of balance is the division by 10,000 in the arguments of the sines and cosines. Finding the correct order of magnitude of the frequency is not straightforward. And all these problems come why? Because we add positional embeddings to word vectors and risk mixing up information. So, of course, people have been also trying other things to counter this, like concatenating positional embeddings instead of adding them. This opens a whole new dimension of possibilities, quite literally. Now the semantic information has its own dimensions to live in, and positional information is encoded somewhere else, in an orthogonal, thus unrelated space to the semantic one. This completely avoids information mess, but comes at a cost. Memory, parameters, runtime, all the bad things. We could let the positional embeddings have their own dimensions in two ways. If we have the parameter budget, we could add extra dimensions for encoding position. In terms of compute, it's like going from bird base to bird large. This luxury comes at a cost, where these extra dimensions will negatively impact the memory and computation footprint down the line in the attention computation and number of neurons in the fully connected layer afterwards. The other option is to take some of the dimensions away from the word vectors and use them only for positional information. This means that the semantic representational capacity of the model is reduced. It's like going from bird large to bird base. So to take a bird eye view again. Adding positional embeddings to word vectors is for the poor but balanced ones that do not afford the extra model capacity but can keep their position on the thin line between semantic or positional takeover. Concatenation is for the rich, in the sense that they have larger GPUs with more memory, or perhaps are lucky with simpler tasks that do not need a model with greater expressivity to better capture. Memorize semantic information. Maybe adding and concatenating are not that different after all. At least this is perhaps why there is no clear winner here when we think about performance on tasks of added versus concatenated positional embeddings. What if, in these high dimensions that we cannot imagine, the word vectors and positional embeddings are almost orthogonal anyway? So it would be actually safe to add them, because the model could disentangle them in the next layers already. Miss Coffee Bean isn't sure about this though, but one thing is clear. Concatenation ensures orthogonality and no mix-up. Adding the positional embeddings does not, and it still seems to work just fine, with a little bit of tuning, and has lower computational cost. But okay, I get it. You do not want to do the tuning yourself. So why shouldn't you do what every machine learner does? Let the transformer figure out for itself what it needs as positional embeddings. Let the child or the machine learn by itself. And here we are already in the realm of learned positional embeddings, a realm visited by language models like BERT, Roberta, GPT-2, and where image models like VIT and DEIT have experimented too. Especially when you have no idea about how to handcraft positional encodings for your data because you're working with modalities that are not so explored in terms of positional embeddings like text is, why not learn them? Interestingly enough, this idea of learnable positional embeddings precedes the Attention is All You Need paper and aims to learn some vectors, which you can add to your input, with the same procedure as with any other parameter in your model with SGD and backpropagation. And hereby the network learns interesting and sometimes surprising things. For example, masked language modeling objectives in BERT or Roberta seem to enforce less structure on the positional embeddings than autoregressive models like GPT-2. A model that must complete the sequence left to right has more incentives to focus on position. And we can see this in the cosine similarity plot of positional embeddings in GPT-2. Positional embeddings become similar to their neighboring position, similarity which grows weaker while going further in the sequence. But also long-term relations emerge, with embeddings having high cosine similarity to embeddings farther away in a periodic pattern. In BERT, this looks very different with positional embeddings that have only a very narrow pattern. This kind of makes sense because replacing a masked word is much more dependent on the immediate neighbors. But the thing with learned positional embeddings is they do not seem to consistently outperform their handcrafted variants. The Attention is All You Need paper tried out learned positional embeddings long before BERT, but it did not seem to outperform their handcrafted Fourier-inspired sinusoidal embeddings. And you have no idea how much sense it makes to Miss Coffee Bean, because it is very similar to the evolution of self-attention that was recently handcrafted with the Fourier transform. It seems like research is going in a circle, or rather a spiral, because there is progress. But look, the original transformer paper tried out handcrafted sinusoidal positional encodings and learned once, but could not measure the superiority of one over the other. Then BERT, Roberta, GPT-2 and so on all came and advertised learned positional embeddings. Learned positional embeddings have also been tried out in the An Image is Worth 16 by 16 pixels with VIT, but also with no significant gains over the default encodings that were just numbering image patches. So again, a loss for the learned version. But let's zoom out a bit, because this is exactly what happens with attention too. Learned quadratically scaling attention has been haunting us for a while now, but lately there have been alternatives, like the FNet, completely hard-coding self-attention with the Fourier transform, where the idea is super similar to sinusoidal positional embeddings. I don't know, but Miss Coffee Bean sees these parallels between the opinion oscillation in the community, between learned or not-so-learned self-attention replacements, and between hard-coded and learned positional embeddings. So what are your favorites? Are you following the church of added or the church of concatenated positional embeddings? Are you more a fan of learned or handcrafted positional embeddings? Let us know in the comments. And as requested by you, the next video will be about relative positional embeddings. It does not fit in this video because your coffee break should now already be over. Go back to work. Or whatever else you need to do, like watch another